alive. Jump in the shower. Good morning and welcome to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. This is a show where we keep you inspired and have fun doing it along the way. We are excited to be brought to you live from beautiful downtown Santa Clarita, which I will add is absolutely gorgeous this morning. It's awesome outside. We are at KHTS 1220 AM and 98.1 FM, and we are excited and think we have a great show for you today. We have the perfect guest with us. He is the president of Century 21 Everest in the state of California. He is also the co-founder of the Everest Group, which spans two states, so he can certainly speak to our topic. Good morning, John Syatt.
Good morning. You make me sound like a really big deal. I don't know that
you
I'm that big of a deal.
You are. You're a big deal to me. Yeah, and not to mention just overall stellar human being.
Oh, you're very kind.
So, well, it's all true. So what I wanted to talk about this morning with you, I think it affects all of us. Just even this morning, I felt it. Got up, got the kids ready, made a hot breakfast, which is important to me, got them off to school, started answering emails, fed the dogs, so on and so forth. And I have to shapeshift constantly, you know, being very successful in my job and trying to be an awesome mother, friend, wife, etc.
Right.
I feel like sometimes it's really hard for me to achieve a level of balance that I'm comfortable with. It seems like something always has to give. So where are you in your life? Do you feel like you have a really well-balanced life, or do you think it's a constant struggle?
You know, it's a great question, and it's a question that I get asked a lot. Part of it is because of the size of company that I lead and my responsibilities within the organization. Let me kind of give you a little bit of background, and then let's address that great question. You know, a decade ago, I had lost everything financially. I didn't go bankrupt, but I could have. I just chose not to do that. Ended up with basically nothing in the bank and a whole lot of, mental and emotional hurt, you know, when you lose everything.
Yeah, and uncertainty, right? I can imagine.
A ton of uncertainty.
Yeah.
It was a challenging time, and chose to, with my best friend, start a company. And a decade ago, we did that, Ground Zero with no employees. And here today, we have a company that has over 1,100 people in it, spanning two states. It's a, relatively speaking, a large organization.
It's huge. And you oversee all of that. So you're overseeing 1,100 employees on a daily basis.
Correct.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of obligation there. And so the whole question of can there be balance, it's a valid question. And I think that we've got to be careful about, you know, our expectations as it relates to really what balance means, because life is always in flux.
It is. I'm a perfect example of that. I'm a constant shapeshifter because I'm so desirous to be exceptional in about five areas that I've chosen that I think are really
right.
important. And when I feel like something's giving in one area, sometimes, you know, if I've taken three listings, I'm high-fiving myself because I'm so excited about the business. However, the kids didn't get a home-cooked meal the last two nights.
Right. Yeah. I like to use the analogy of, you know, like those water weenies. You grab a hold of it, and it slips out of your hands.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, it's just that tube of water, and you can't quite grasp it. Well, I think that life is oftentimes like that in terms of trying to balance. Here's probably the best way to look at it. Speaking from the general, then getting to the specific, I think that there are three primary categories in every person's life. There are the relationships, both with ourselves and then with others. And others I would define as our creator, whatever sort of definition you assign to our creator.
Yeah, your
energy,
your faith, whatever that
whatever
faith
it
is put in. It could
be energy,
things.
Gaia,
yes.
God, Buddha, yeah. Whatever.
Yeah.
There's that relationship, and then your relationship with your significant other, your family members, your friends, your coworkers, your community members, and then strangers. So it's going to be any relationship that you're in, starting with yourself and going all the way through. The second category is going to be our health, our mental, our physical, and our emotional health, and then our spiritual health. And then the third and final category would be our finances, generally speaking. And for those who own a business, their business and what all of that looks like. But at the end of the day, it comes down to the money. So when we talk about balance, well, balance within the confines of those three broad categories, right?
Right. The things that you care about are where you're striving to have the balance. I line mine out slightly different. You have the three categories. I have the five Fs, but it's basically the same thing. My five Fs are faith, family, fitness, financial, and friends, which also lends itself to fun.
There you go.
Sometimes I feel, well, I always feel like if you're waning in any one of those areas, you're not living your best life. But however, I often find that if I'm just knocking it dead in three or four of those categories, then something else isn't as, you know, productive or as bountiful as I want it to be.
Yep.
So it's just, do I, when I look at balance, am I looking over the year as a whole? Am I looking into daily, is it daily balance? Is it a weekly balance? Kind of how do you structure it to keep sane? Because I'm busy, John, but you are crazy busy.
Yeah. What we really have to do is take a look at ultimately what it is we want our life to be about. And life is seasonal. And what I mean by that is this, that there are seasons within our lives where certain things are going to be more important, where we should be spending more of our time and spending more of our focus. You, for example, as a mother of, you know, teenage boys, time with them now is a little bit more intense than it's going to be, say, 5 years from now when they've...
Yes. When they don't want to be anywhere near me.
Well, or that, you know, they're out of the house or in college or whatever,
yeah.
Right?
Although they're teenage boys, they find me irritating right now anyway. So but I'm just keep chasing
normal,
them around,
right?
Trying to love them. Yeah.
Yeah, but we find that in these situations that it's seasonal, it's transitional. Everything over time gets off course, and that's a really important observation.
Yeah, and you have to put it back in course. So
we have to. We have to. But things are going to take priority. And so the question of, is balance possible? Well, I think it can be transitionally, but can we have balance constantly, always? And my answer to that is no, but it doesn't mean we don't strive towards it. Really, the key is striving towards balance so that we have as much balance as possible. Here's the best way to visually see it. Imagine three plates on a stick that we have to spin. And those plates have to be spun. If they don't, they wobble out of control and they fall off of the stick, right? Well, that's kind of like life.
You got to run back to one plate when it slows down and run back.
Right.
Yeah, but that's where the chaos feels. So you are listening to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. We have a special guest in studio today, John Syatt, the president of Century 21 Everest in Southern California, the co-founder of the Everest Group, which spans two states, which is incredibly impressive. He oversees 11,000, let's call them team members.
Mm-hmm.
However, I feel like my life is crazy busy also, and we're speaking to that. So, John, I do agree with you that you really have to look over an extended period of time when you're looking at balance and not become frustrated and really not beat yourself up. When, you know, I was a stay-at-home mom for years, and I lived that, and I loved it. But, however, my business is absolutely flourishing, and since the answer to the customer is always yes,
right,
sometimes other things have to go to the wayside. So if someone calls me and I need to go, then my workout, I don't get my workout that day, but
yep.
I try to console myself with, well, at least if I work out X amount of times this week, I'm still ahead of the game.
Yep.
So how do you manage to fit it in? Do you work by a calendar? Do you just have an overall game plan?
Well, so I first start with the concept of the idea that greater balance is always achievable. So I don't try to achieve absolute balance, but always just work to improve to get to greater balance.
So progress, not perfection.
Correct.
Okay. That's one of my favorite lines, by the way.
Because what we have a tendency to do is, you said, beat ourselves up.
Yeah.
And so what we have to recognize is if we can get to greater balance, then we're achieving something, right?
Yeah, we can just kind of gain on it. Like,
yeah.
if we're always gaining on it, we can't help feel, you know, we can only feel good about that.
So this is the way that I work at it, and this is the process that I use. Again, I categorize it. I've got my relationships, my health, and then my finances or my business.
And, well, you're a fitness too. Yeah, you're a great workout guy.
Thank you. I work at it. It's hard work. But what I've done is I've recognized the importance of those areas and understand that they're interdependent. So, for example, if my relationships are not going well, it has a tendency to affect my mental well-being, which is the second category, which is health.
Exactly.
It starts to undermine that. And then if I start to feel bad emotionally, I tend to feel bad physically, which then affects my ability to be
fit,
effective in the business.
Yeah,
right?
The whole thing. It's one.
They're interdependent.
Yeah, they certainly are.
One affects the other. Here's a great visual. Imagine a three-legged stool. That three-legged stool has three distinct legs that are there to support the stool. If you pull one of the legs out from underneath the stool, what happens to it? It collapses.
Just collapses.
No choice.
Exactly.
It collapses. Well, those three pillars in life are the same thing. They're interdependent. One depends upon the other. And so when we find a lack of balance in one area, it bleeds to the other one. But it doesn't mean, and I'm saying this because I want your listeners to know and understand, that if they have imbalance in their life, it doesn't make them abnormal. It is very...
No, it makes them normal.
It makes them normal. Yeah. But what we want to be is abnormal.
Yeah.
Right? We really want to be abnormal in that we recognize it, that there is imbalance, and then we start to do some things to bring back some balance in that area. Greater balance.
And I don't think, and I'm just speaking for myself and the way my life has shaped up, I don't think it's 100% attainable at any given moment.
I don't think it is either.
Okay.
So, and I think that we should all acknowledge that so that we feel better about it.
Exactly.
And we're not trying to achieve something that's not achievable.
Yeah. That, and that's kind of what the whole show is about today. Are we chasing something that's elusive, or I think we got to get in the zone where it's progress, not perfection. You know, when I feel like I haven't cooked enough that week for the kids, then maybe something else gives, and then I try to make up for that. But I also don't want to get stuck in the rut where I feel like I'm constantly trying to make up for something. So I think there's a grace involved there. So if something does go by the wayside, I tend to give myself grace and just think, well, you know what? We're going to do that better next time.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it makes sense to me.
So to get to your question, get really specific, I always make certain that I am living by design or with intention.
Okay.
One of the things that I do, I always ask this question as I'm coaching, training, and speaking, working with people, asking them a question, when did today start? And they think when I ask that question, I'm asking them, well, what time did you get up? That is not the question.
No, it started 10 years ago.
Well, the issue is really, it has to be by design. Today should have, for all of us, started yesterday.
Yes.
We should have acknowledged and examined what is it we wanted to accomplish today, last night. So before I go to bed, I always take a look at my schedule. Okay, does it have everything in there that I want it to have? And do I have activities in there that are by design going to give me the results that I want?
And the life that you want. Actually, that's a great idea. I might start doing that. I do not do that, and that's a great idea. What I do is I find out I'm a reactive a lot of times. You know, the kids need to be here. I need to do this at work. This needs to get done.
Right.
So I set up my schedule according to what needs to be done, what can't go by the wayside. I don't generally set it up with, you know what are two things I would enjoy that I want to do today, and then build the schedule around that.
Well, the way you said you do it, that is very normal, and it's called the routine. Some people call it the rat race, right? There are those who are, and you're highly successful, and you have to give yourself more credit because I know that you do live by design to a very large degree.
Oh, I do.
But what we have to do is recognize that there's a greater sense of control and conscious recognition of things that we can do and need to do in order to live not a life of routine, but live a life by a specific routine. I know it sounds...
No, I'd say it again, just because so that people can get the distinction.
Yeah, it's a life not of routine, but a life by a specific routine, right? In other words, we're not just in
that
the routine.
That you've decided, right.
But it's by design.
Yes.
Right? Routines are very important. We have like an exercise routine. We have great routines to maintain great relationships. But it has to be consciously recognized, and we put it into the schedule to make certain we're getting the results that we want and not just simply living in the slipstream of life like most people do.
No, and I agree with you. And I think that's what I have done instinctively. I don't know why I was so fortunate, probably because I had a great mother. But I also agree that today started 10 years ago.
Yes.
We're on the air today because of decisions I made 5 years ago,
absolutely,
10 years ago, 15 years ago. You know, just belief, enthusiasm, just the ability, if a door is open, to step through it, to embrace being scared and do something anyway. And then that becomes easy. And then you find something else that scares you a little bit and you do it.
That statement that you made is so powerful, that what you are doing today and the life that you're living today was about the decisions that you've taken up to this point. That is about taking control and recognizing responsibility. Those who take control and take responsibility for their circumstances will never be victims. It doesn't mean bad things will happen to them, because they will. Bad things do happen to good people.
Bad things happen to everyone.
But when you recognize what you just said, that principle, it's very powerful. It's very empowering. So I just start with intention. The night before, I look at, okay, what am I going to accomplish tomorrow? What do I have to do to accomplish it?
I love that.
Because clarity creates power. The more clear about what it is that I want.
Clarity creates power.
Clarity creates power. Knowing what I want and what I have to do to get it means that it's more likely that I'm going to get what it is that I want. The reason that Michael Jordan won about 2/3 of his games is because he worked from intention every moment. It doesn't mean that he won 100% of his games, and that's what I want people to hear.
Right.
He still lost a third of his games, over a third of his games.
But it's the overall.
But it was the overall performance, and he was able to do that because he acted with greater intention than his competitors.
Now, I see that when you coach new agents. I think part of the hard part about coaching new agents when they come in, you get amazing people that have enthusiasm. You need to show them the vision down the road if they put the work in early. Because real estate's a tough job, but it's a very wonderful job if you're successful at it. So you're working, you're always working for the future. You're laying the groundwork all the time. And always. I see that when you're coaching new agents.
Always. So going back to how do we create greater balance? How do we find that progress? Well, we start first of all with identifying what our intentions are, what we want to accomplish, and then what we have to do that. In other words, living by design, not reacting, but being proactive. We call them first responders and not first reactors for a reason. Our police officers, our fire department, our emergency medical services, our military men and women, they don't react.
React, yeah. They're not playing defense.
They're not defense. Reactors. They're responders.
Yes.
Because they know what the mission is. They've trained themselves how to respond mentally, physically, and emotionally. And as a result, they are calm, cool, and collected when bombs go off, bullets fly,
exactly.
And people need help.
Well, we're going to take a short break. So when we come back, you're going to tell us how to do that?
Yes.
Okay. You're listening to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno, and we want you to stay inspired. So please come back after the break, and we'll see you in a few minutes.
The best live theater can be found right here in the Santa Clarita Valley. The Canyon Theater Guild has been entertaining audiences for decades with top quality musicals and plays. Located on Main Street in Old Town Newhall, CTG also offers workshops for the young actor in your family. For more information, call the box office at 799-2702 or go online to canyontheater.org.
Being a dynamic woman in Santa Clarita definitely has its challenges. The kids, school, work, and then of course there's the husband. How do we juggle it all, stay motivated, and keep a smile on our face? That's what we're going to discuss. Join me Monday at 11 a.m. for Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. This is a program that will inspire you to grow as we discuss issues that impact all of us. We'll have plenty to chat about, and if nothing else, we'll be sure to keep a smile on your face. I would love for you to join me Monday at 11 a.m. on KHTS.
Hometown, your hometown station.
Welcome back to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno, the show where we keep you inspired and have fun along the way. We are here with our, probably my favorite guest of all time, Mr. John Syatt, who Good morning. Who is president of Century 21 Everest here in the state of California and co-founder of the Everest Group, which spans two states. So this topic couldn't be better for him. We're talking today about balance. The illusion, is it an illusion? Can we attain it? Does it exist? Should we be striving for it? Should we feel bad when we don't have it? John and I are just exploring the different ways to really react to it and try to accomplish it. He just gave me a great tagline. He said, clarity creates power. I love that statement.
Yeah.
So speak a little more to that, if you would.
Well, nobody likes uncertainty, not when it comes to life and the things that we expect and want and are most important to us. It's not that we don't like spontaneity. We do. We like surprises. We like surprise presence, surprise birthday parties, those sorts of things. But there are certain things we don't want to be surprised by, right?
No.
So there is a difference between reacting and responding. We should never in life be surprised that bad things or challenging things are going to happen. Here's a great way to look at it. Imagine a prize fighter, a boxer, in a ring, and they get punched in the face. And imagine that boxer being surprised that they got punched in the face.
Yeah, that wouldn't work.
It wouldn't work.
No.
Prize fighters expect that they don't want to, and they do everything they can to avoid it.
Yeah.
But when it happens, because they know that it will, they're not surprised by it, and they know how to respond. It's so interesting that the average person it seems like the way they respond when something bad goes on or happens around them, that they react to it as opposed to responding.
Well, and they're surprised. I remember my mom telling me something. We were talking about bills and we were doing, we were doing a budget.
Yeah.
And then, off to the side, we're doing the slush budget. I'm like, we probably won't need that. And she goes, you don't understand. Life happens. Life will always happen every month, every year. Life will happen just exactly that reason. You don't want to be surprised when you need four new tires. You don't want to be surprised when my son knocked his two front teeth out. So now we're going to, put two new front teeth in.
Right.
So you're right. And the story I can really speak to that I can relate to that is when I first started real estate, I tend to think of myself as a shapeshifter and a free spirit, and really thought that I could just do things when I wanted to and how I wanted to.
Right.
But as I became more successful and more people were dependent on me, my mentor at the time kept encouraging me to work by calendar. And I won't, it's embarrassing now to tell you how long I fought working by a calendar. I seemed, it sounds goofy, but it seemed like mundane. I wasn't going to sit down. That seems superfluous. Sit down and
right.
write everything down. Oh my gosh, fast forward a decade and I cannot live without my calendar. It structures out my whole day. Does it change? Absolutely.
Of course.
And do I still shapeshift like crazy? Of course I do. I'm a mom. I get calls, you know, so on and so forth. But now that calendar really helps me organize and outline my week. And I think it helps me be more successful at the end of the day.
Bingo. That calendar creates greater clarity.
Yep.
And people who produce at a higher level on a day-to-day basis are always more organized, more scheduled in their activities. You take a look at the leader of the free world, any president from the beginning of this nation
now,
to
John,
the current
Now, John, don't
one.
Get crazy here. We don't want
gonna,
to go into a bad
gonna get in
political situation
we're not
gonna,
here. No, we're not going to
do that. I got to watch him.
Let's
watch
talk
him.
About the office.
Yes.
We're not talking about
okay.
any particular person. But you look at what the president of the United States accomplishes on a daily basis in terms of their obligations, the other foreign leaders that they have to meet with, our own politicians, our senators and our representatives in the House, department heads and so forth. And then just the people that, you know, the babies they got to kiss and the hands they have
yeah.
to shake, everything that's expected of them within their role, to look how much they accomplish. They're able to accomplish so much, not just because they have assistants and they have people who work for them, but they still have to do the work. They still have
yes.
to show up and have those conversations. And they're able to get more done in their day than most people do because they
probably
are,
in a month, yeah.
Yes, because they're highly scheduled.
Yep.
So how do we create greater balance? How do we progress towards greater balance in our life? Well, we start with intention and then having a schedule that creates greater clarity, because with clarity there is power, which means we get to act with greater intention. When we're clear about what we want and what we have to do to get it, we act more powerfully and we get better results.
Well, and as I'm thinking about it and as I'm watching you say this, that not only lends itself to somebody that runs 1,100 agents,
yes.
or team members of
mm-hmm.
whatever capacity they're in. Yeah.
Yep.
But that also relates to, I remember the years as a stay-at-home mom, I was able to get a tremendous amount accomplished because I really, really did have a tight routine. You know, we
yep.
did this, and then we did this, and then we did this, and nap time was here. You know, we were able to really accomplish a lot. So whether you're a stay-at-home mom or whether you're running whether you're the president of 1,100 people, I think it kind of is the same. The intention has to be there.
It is the same. It is the same. It's irrelevant, whatever your role is. The principles are the same. They apply to all of us. We are not an exception to the rules. We either recognize them and live by them, right, or we ignore them, and then we get penalized.
Awesome. So you're listening to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. A special guest today is John Syatt. He is the president of Century 21 Everest here in Southern California. And we are speaking to the subject of balance. We are two highly motivated, highly successful. Some might say John already has it all, but I know he's not even slowing down. He just achieves something and goes on to the next thing. So one of the things I want to talk to you about, John, one of the things I think lends itself to your success, and I don't know if this is good with a balance topic, but whoever you're with, this is interesting to me, whoever you're with feels like they're the only person in the room. And I think in a weird way that does lend itself to balance, because even if you don't have a lot of time with individuals, mm-hmm. if you have a minute, 2 minutes, 5 minutes, and you make them feel like $100,
yep.
then that's probably low for this day and age. If you make them feel like $1 million.
With inflation.
Yeah, we're going to have to go to $1 million. If you make them in those 2 or 3 minutes, and even with your children, with your girlfriends, with your family members, even with my mom, if I laser focus on her for the time I do have with her,
yeah.
then we can go longer and she doesn't feel like I'm neglecting her, because
yeah.
my mom and I are really, really close. So do you find that that's one of the skills I really see that you possess, and maybe it lends itself to being able to move amongst so many people and so many, you know, dates on your calendar and things you have to attend to?
It's a great question. I love it. There's so much to be said about it. First of all, what I believe is at the end of our days, the most important thing that we will have experienced and enjoyed and taken from this life will be our relationships, the people in our lives.
It's the only thing. Love is the only thing.
We don't take anything with us physically. With all of this stuff, the material
no.
stuff, we don't get to take that with us. But we do get to leave something behind, and that's our legacy. The legacy meaning, how did we affect the people who remain? It's critical. And here's what I know. You cannot be efficient with people. people aren't a process. They're not a system. They're people. They are emotional, right? They are driven by passion. They're affected by fear. And so we have to recognize that, one, the most important thing is people. We cannot be efficient with them. But that if we spend time in understanding what – this is critical. I'm gonna repeat this a couple of times. Expectations are critical when it comes to relationships.
It is. And all people, regardless of who they are, only want two fundamental things. They want love and they want respect.
That's it.
And if you can convey that to the person, whether it's in a minute or 5 minutes or it takes you 6 hours – they feel special to you. And yeah. I think that's one thing that you're really, really good at.
Well, look, none of us is going to accomplish what we want in life without the assistance and cooperation of other people. We need to acknowledge that and admit that. As good as we might think we are individually, at the end of the day, we're going to need somebody else's assistance or many people's assistance. And it's not about taking advantage of people, but it's recognizing that there has to be, there's a Latin phrase called quid pro quo. There's got to be something for something. Every relationship is a dynamic of at least two people, right? Each expecting something out of the relationship. And it's important for us in a relationship to understand what one we expect out of it, but also what the other person expects.
Yeah, we want to give and get. We want it to be symbiotic.
That's right. It has to be symbiotic.
Yeah.
So ultimately, relationships do not go well when expectations are not discovered and therefore not met. Or they could be discovered. You know, we know what the other person
needs.
Yeah,
I know what you want.
But we're not delivering it.
Yeah, exactly.
That's a problem.
Yeah, in business or personally.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
I mean, in an intimate relationship, if it's a couple and they're married, that gap between what is expected and what's actually happening, if we're not meeting the expectations, that gap is called divorce oftentimes.
Yeah,
right?
It is. Or a great anguish if you don't get to the divorce part.
Yeah.
Because you're not fulfilled.
You're not fulfilled. Yeah. You're not happy. So it's really critical that... it's a very important question that we recognize how important relationships are, and it really is the most important thing at the end of our days, and working to discover expectations, both ours and theirs, and then having those conversations. You know, you, especially as driven as you are and as successful as you are and as busy as you are, it's important that with those in your life, for example, your boys, that as you take time away from them, that they understand why and what the schedule is so that they buy off on it so that you don't feel guilty or pressured.
Well, and I do have a lot of mommy guilt, I'll tell you that, as my business has just flourished unbelievably. It's absolute blessing, and I am so grateful. But I do have that, like, shoot, I didn't personally make them three meals a day. I went from being a stay-at-home mom and to becoming very successful. So something had to give, even though I do feel like I do have pretty good balance. But you can't do everything all day. So you do have to give yourself a break. But I do get those pangs of, oh, shoot, you know, that's two nights in a row where, you know.
But here's the thing. The best way to get over that is to discover what's most important to your boys.
That's a great idea.
And how they want to spend time with you.
That's a great idea.
For you as a mother, you may define, well, listen, they look at me as a great mother if I am home by 5 o'clock every night fixing them dinner and we eat dinner together. And the boys might say, well, no, Mom, look, I get it. And we want to do that once in a while. But really, going on that vacation once or twice a year with you to Maui or to Miami or to New York or whatever, that would be important to us.
Okay, you just gave me an absolute light bulb moment, which you always do when I'm with you. One advice that you probably gave me 5 years ago, which has absolutely paid off in spades, was when I go to a listing appointment, mm-hmm. my second category of questions that I ask is always, what is your expectation of me?
Yeah.
Please let me know what your expectation is so I can meet and exceed it, because my business is built by referral. And if I make you happy, you'll certainly refer me. But you know what, John? I have never sat down with my two sons across the kitchen table and went, what's your expectation? What if Mom can only have X amount of hours of the day with you or for you or whatever, what is most important to you? Do you know that I've never asked them that?
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, it is. It's amazing. I ask that question 5 times a week to people I don't know.
It's what I said just a few minutes ago, that these principles apply to us no matter who we are and what we're
doing.
Yeah,
across the
board. This is all personal development stuff. This is all life stuff. It doesn't matter what you do.
Yeah, what if you went to your husband and just said, what's your expectation of me?
Yeah, what would you like this to look like?
Yeah.
What a powerful...
They'd probably say, what's the catch? What do you,
right.
you know?
What do you want? What's going
what's
on?
What's happening? What are you trying to do? But after they got over it initially, when they found you were serious, I think it goes back to love and respect. How respected does any person, whether it's a client, a husband, a best friend, a child, feel when you're asking them what do they want, and to help you get it for them.
Well, it goes back to what you said about the love and respect, those two fundamental human needs, this love and this validation. Asking the question about what they expect and giving them an opportunity to express themselves goes a long way towards validating them and letting them know that they are important to you. What a better way to build a relationship than that? I can't think of one.
No, it's
asking that
brilliant
question. Yeah.
And quite frankly, if they lay out an expectation that you know you can't possibly meet, you can also say that. That's fair.
And you can negotiate through
yes
it.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I can't be home 7 nights a week. How about this? I'll be home 5. I'll make you a home-cooked meal. But when I'm on the weekends, I'm busy, then something has to give. Or mom needs to work out and I right have to leave early before school. Whatever the subject
whatever
matter is. Yeah.
So here's just, I'm going to give a quick plug here for a book. People are interested as they're listening and they want to, particularly with their spouse or their partner, if they want the relationship to improve and to function at a higher level where it's gratifying for both, the book called The 5 Love Languages.
I knew you were going to say that. That is one of my favorite books.
It's about, going back to what we're talking about discovering expectations and meeting those, right? And really
yeah
having the
because
conversations.
Because you can't refute it. It's unrefutable.
It is absolutely irrefutable. And the key is that it opens up the conversation to have honest conversations about what is it that we're missing? How could I better provide for you in this relationship so that you feel better? And here's the thing. When we're in a relationship, when the other person feels good, feels better, we feel better.
Of course we do. So you are listening to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno here on KHTS, 1220 AM, 98.1 FM. Our guest today is John Syatt, and we are speaking to the subject of balance, and there is no one better equipped to speak to the subject of balance than John. Whereas I think I'm high-functioning, high-achieving, and accomplish more in one day than most people, John probably accomplishes more in one day than, I don't know, most people do in 2 months. So, John, I love everything that you're bringing to the table on this subject. I think you're right on the money. And how do you personally, if you seem to get off or veer one way or another, how do you right the ship back to where it needs to be?
Well, for me, the cornerstone is always my mindset. The most important asset that we all have, aside from the relationships in our lives, is our mindset. And that really speaks to the relationship we have with ourselves, because our mindset is nothing more than the conversation that we have with ourselves in our own brain.
Very I agree.
Important.
I totally agree.
That is the relationship.
That is the relationship. In fact, when you were talking about sitting down with your husband and asking them what their expectation is and how you can meet it, I imagine that would give somebody angst or some people angst. And you have to really look at why do I have angst asking the person I love what they want.
Yeah.
So that's interesting.
Oh, mindset is critical. And here's what I know. Life will throw stuff at us that we don't want, we didn't ask for, don't need it, and yet we're going to have these challenges. And the only way to address them and overcome them is to have the right mindset. So here's one of the things that I acknowledge. Bad things will happen to me, right? And I can either choose to be a victim and say, look what life is doing to me. Look what that person did.
Yeah,
look
I
what's
agree
happening to the economy. Look what he's doing, she's doing. Because we're in the business of real estate, you know, inventories are tight. Interest rates are potentially going up, whatever the story is, right? And those start to become excuses for us not to achieve.
Yeah, it's just negative rhetoric in your head.
It's all negative.
Yeah.
Versus not owning any of that and just simply saying, there are things in life that I can control and things that I can't control. And the number one thing that we can control, and we need to acknowledge it, is our mindset. And so it doesn't matter what's happening out there in the world.
It doesn't.
What matters is what's happening in here in our brain.
So let me ask you this. I was really fortunate to be raised by my mom and my aunts that really kind of instinctively have that. So I've been really lucky that, you know, really since a young age recognize that that more, I don't use the phrase ever, what's happening to me. I always feel like being grateful for what I have, what can I do, what can I give, where can I go next, da-da-da-da. Were you kind of born and raised that way, or did you have to fight for that mindset?
You know, both, actually. I'm fortunate because I had a mother who...
Well, hold on. We're going to have to take a break real quick because I want to hear this. As soon as you go into your mother's story, I want the full thing and I don't want to be it
fair
broken
enough
up. So we're going to take a quick break. You are listening to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno and John Syatt this morning, and we'll see you after break. Thank you.
Life's not meant to feel complacent. It's meant to make you feel alive. The youth ministry at the Church on the Way Santa Clarita believes that students can belong to the group where we will help them believe they have a purpose in Christ and become all that He has created them to be. We want to see God's power come alive in our generation. We love meeting new people, so come hang out with us. Doors open at 6 p.m. and service starts at 7 every Wednesday night. For more information about the Church on the Way Santa Clarita, including service times and what's happening through the end of the year, visit TCOTWSC.org.
The Art Gallery of Santa Clarita Artists Association, located in downtown Newhall on 6th Street between Railroad and Main, features local members' original artwork with changing exhibits every 2 months. Purchase affordable art for your home or as gifts. Open Friday through Sunday or by appointment. Artists wishing to join the SCAA can visit SantaClaritaArtist.org, come to our free monthly meetings at Barnes & Noble, or stop by the gallery. For upcoming shows, check us out at SantaClaritaArtist.org. We make visual art visible.
Aloha, friends. Go check out Honu Coffee, home of the best cold brew coffee. What makes their coffee special is how their organic coffee beans are infused with nitrogen to create a smooth and delicious cup of coffee. You'll also find traditional bold coffees and island-inspired signature drinks. They're the perfect place to catch up with friends or just relax with your favorite cup of joe. Honu Coffee on Lyons and Walnut in Newhall. Stop by and say aloha.
And now for your convenience, a second Honu location at 23502 Lyons Avenue between Peachland and Apple.
Being a dynamic woman in Santa Clarita definitely has its challenges. The kids, school, work, and then of course there's the husband. How do we juggle it all, stay motivated, and keep a smile on our face? That's what we're going to discuss. Join me Monday at 11 a.m. for Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. This is a program that will inspire you to grow as we discuss issues that impact all of us. We'll have plenty to chat about, and if nothing else, we'll be sure to keep a smile on your face. I would love for you to join me Monday at 11 a.m. on KHTS.
Hey there, it's Tori with your hometown station weather. Mostly sunny this week with highs in the mid-70s and overnight lows in the low 50s. For anything and everything Santa Clarita Valley related, go to hometownstation.com. Or you can find us on social media, Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at KHTS Radio.
Your hometown station.
KHTS, your hometown station.
Welcome back to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. We are talking today about balance, and John is just about to tell us a fantastic story. John Syatt, who is president of Century 21 Everest in Southern California and co-founder of the Everest Group, which spans two states. So he's a very, very busy man. We're very fortunate to have him here today. But when it comes to balance, I couldn't think of anybody better to speak to balance because he has 1,100 team members, family, children, goes on vacation, works out consistently. I mean, he really seems to be achieving it all. So we're just trying to glean a little bit of knowledge from him. And we just were speaking to, was he born with the mindset of the can-do mindset, or did he really have to work at being able to achieve that mindset to where it was a default for him?
Yeah. And it's a question of nature and nurture. Can they both have an impact? And I believe that they do. I think there are people who are predisposed to having a positive mindset, but it doesn't mean that they are going to. It just means it might be easier for them, based upon the way they're wired, to be more optimistic than another person. And then there are those where they have to work harder at it. But at the end of the day, ultimately, I believe that we have to assume responsibility and take control for the way we think and the way we feel. We can either be an optimist or a pessimist. We're not born either way. We can be a victim or we can be a victor.
Yes.
We can take control or give up responsibility.
Yes.
I was fortunate because you asked the question, you know, growing up, what did that look like? I was fortunate that I had a mother who recognized that her self-confidence was not very high. The way she looked at herself, she was pretty critical of herself, and she acknowledged that. In fact,
which is interesting that you can acknowledge it and still not feel empowered to be able to do something about it. I bet we have listeners that feel that way.
I'll bet.
Yeah.
But what my mom did, and it was very interesting, fortunately for me, that she exerted that frustration and the energy from that through me. And I remember her saying to me, I was relatively young, she said, "You are not going to be like me." In terms of that lack of confidence.
She wanted better for you, like every mom.
Every parent would,
yeah,
right?
Like every
That's
parent,
our responsibility.
Right.
That's the legacy we live. Give
it
them
is.
A life that's better than the one that we have.
Yeah.
Well, she made it really clear that that was not going to be my experience. And so she would do things like when it was time for milk and eggs, she would hand me the money and say, "Go in."
Yeah.
And you get it. And you have it. Because I didn't want to have the conversations and look at the clerk or ask questions.
No, we didn't either. And we had a thing when my mom had an absolute zero tolerance for feeling sorry for yourself. That was just not on the table.
Right.
So as we became angsty teenagers and felt disgruntled for whatever reason that morning or that day, we would promptly be taken to help the homeless or promptly be taken to, back then you could go in the convalescent homes and give small hard candies to the, you can't anymore because now they, if there's diabetes or there's health
liabilities,
issues.
Yeah.
But back then you could absolutely go and visit people that didn't have anybody else to talk to or that were a lot down and out on their luck than you were. Because she was very much of that mindset. She had come from poverty and pulled herself up by her bootstraps and was like, "It's not what's happening to you. It's who you are becoming."
Well, see, and I'm certain that there are listeners who are saying, "Well, I didn't grow up in a house like that where I had a mother or a father who did that."
So then
my
what?
Mother was an alcoholic. My father left us or the reverse of that. Or it was there was constant strife and challenge. We were poor, whatever the story is.
Or it could, and honestly, John, because you know all my education's in psychology, there is times when the parents are so high-functioning and optimistic that the children actually go the other way.
They rebel and go
so
a different
direction. So it doesn't matter how you were raised, it's what you do with it yourself after that.
That's it. It's how do we respond to it?
Right.
And so your question of, well, what did it look like for me? Well, that's what it looked like for me. And so it, I guess to some extent it gave me an advantage, but here's the truth. We all have the ability to interpret our circumstances and what happens to us either negatively or positively. It is just a decision.
Yep.
Period.
It's just a decision.
And that is, you will never convince me otherwise. Because I could share some things with you in terms of my personal experience and share with you how I functioned through all of that. And you would, the average person would be surprised. They would say, "Well, how did you get through that? How did you function? How was that
possible?" You made a decision and you moved forward in that direction.
I always say when they ask me, "How are you?" I friends or strangers, and my pat response usually is fantastic or awesome or amazing. And it usually gets a response, "Fantastic, really? I like that. Are you always fantastic?" And my answer is, "Yes, I'm always fantastic." Well, is that a Pollyannish answer? Are you just saying that or do you really mean it? And my answer is, "No, I really mean it. Well, I am fantastic."
Well, and it's both, because the reality is I love to live in Pollyanna because I think you live into your words and your expectations.
You do.
So I always see a silver lining. I mean, I know that, you know, I've had bad things happen too, not as bad as other people, and I don't minimize that for 1 second, but I've always, always tried to find a silver lining. And I also think that when you do have trials and you get through them and it turns out positive, then that's your obligation to help other people that might be having a similar trial or are about to have a trial to say, "Hey, it's okay. I'm on the other side and I've been through this. You know, I have
it's
been
part of the human experience."
That's right. That's right.
It's normal.
So it's just a decision. I try to pass that on to my children because everything you started a company in the worst possible time.
Since the Great Depression.
Yeah.
The worst. And yet
you
we did that.
A real estate company when the real estate market was absolutely.
Hint, real estate caused the collapse, right?
Good point.
We decided to start a company during that time.
Right.
Yeah, crazy.
Yeah.
Again, it goes back to mindset. We just simply have to recognize that it's the most important thing as it relates to our success in navigating life. And mindset is a skill set. Which means it implies that it's something that we can control, we can improve it. Any skill can be improved if we focus on it.
Yes. So the skill of balance, to take it full circle, if you have a mindset that allows yourself to have balance and you work towards that end, you can achieve it because it's a decision.
It is a decision. It is. Yep. And it doesn't mean that at times you're going to feel out of balance. There are times that I feel out of balance. Right. But I come to the table with the right attitude and the mentality that I'll fix it and it's okay. This is very normal. I don't beat myself up. I don't play that game.
You and I both have that in common. So you are listening to Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. We are here at KHTS 1220 AM 98 FM. We are helping you stay inspired. We have fantastic guest, John Syatt. And he is the president of Century 21 Everest here in Southern California. He continually has to check himself on balance. Myself, as a mother who has a successful career, but two boys that certainly need me, and a gym that's calling out to me daily that I can't seem to always get to. We're just speaking to this topic that we really think is universal. And so I John, I couldn't agree more with what you're saying. I think, so what is your advice for someone that's feeling like they can't quite get to where they need to be as far as mindset and far as plugging in? I know we're slightly off topic, but I think they all lend themselves to each other.
It's all the same.
The mindset helps you be successful to need the more balance because you're so successful.
Let's draw that lineage or that connection. So what do I do? Well, I recognize that my mindset, my attitude is the most important thing. The most important thing for your listeners to understand is that their attitude every single day, every single moment is the most important thing because it's their attitude that affects their behavior.
So what happens when you wake up and you don't feel like working out?
I do what I don't feel like doing.
And aren't you the one that told me that successful people are willing to do what other people are not willing to do?
Yeah, that's why they live extraordinary lives.
That's exactly right.
Because they're willing to do what the ordinary person is not willing to do. Ordinary people live an ordinary life because they do ordinary things. Extraordinary people live extraordinary lives because they do extraordinary things.
So if you wake up and it's cold outside and you stayed up too late and you really just don't feel like going to the gym, you're already in amazing shape. There's a case to be made for why you should stay there in bed, all cozy and warm. Yep. What's the self-talk there?
Well, a couple of things. Number one, I make certain that it's not my self-talk that controls. So one of the first things that
Smart.
I do is I put somebody else's voice in my head.
Smart.
So I have mentors, many I've met, some that I have not. And I make certain that I play messages on my phone through the speaker, right, in the morning, blasting on my portable JBL speaker, right, listening to a Tony Robbins or a Zig Ziglar or a Les Brown or a Wayne Dyer. Or a Brian Tracy,
yeah.
Or any number of people whose message and whose voice will inspire me, motivate me, and get my mind right. It's like going to the chiropractor. Once in a while, we got to have our bones cracked to align the system.
Yeah, and I think you also hit the nail on the head when I'm counseling or coaching agents. It doesn't matter what your emotion is at that minute. If you have made a decision to do something, you're probably not going to feel like doing it all the time, which is why you haven't done it thus far. So it just becomes too bad.
Every emotion is transitory. Every emotion is temporary. Whether it's the highest high or the lowest low or any emotion in between, none of that is permanent. And so if we recognize that and then ask the question, okay, what can I do to affect my emotions and then engage in that behavior? So here's what I would say. And if any of your listeners are taking notes, one of the things I always say, man, if you're taking notes, this is the time to write something down. This is really important. It's critical for the way we function on a daily basis. Our thoughts lead to our emotions. So what we think about makes us feel a certain way. So our thoughts lead to our emotions, and then our emotions lead to our actions, and then our actions lead to our results, in other words, our reality. So if our reality isn't what we want it to be, the very first place that we start to change it is the way we are thinking.
Yeah, we've got to back it all the way up.
You got
to back it all the way up. And that's kind of why I wanted to speak to this topic this morning, because I do give myself a lot of grace. That's one benefit I have in my personality. When I am not living up to what I want to live up to, I acknowledge that. I don't beat myself up and I just try to do better. But the decision of trying to find, you know, a high level of achievement in the 5 categories that are very important to me, and I don't want to stop ever until I've achieved that.
Right.
But you also have to find that, you know, it's going to ebb and wane, and you're going to have to shape shift, and that, you know, you can do your very best. It's progress, not perfection.
That's right.
Yeah,
So practically, what can I hand your listeners so that they can walk away saying, okay, I'm going to do this. Start your day with something positive, something that you read, that you watch, or that you listen to, something that inspires and motivates, that makes you feel better about yourself and more capable to go out and achieve the things that you want and live the life that you want. It's critical that that happens.
It is.
Because the average person will have 60,000 thoughts, and the vast majority of those thoughts are negative. Our mind is like a computer, and it has an operating system, and the operating system, Kathleen, has a bug.
Yeah.
It has a bug. And we have to work constantly to get that bug out, to reprogram it, so that this operating system, our brain, is spitting out the right information, the right attitude.
Well, and here's what I know fundamentally. If you're in gratitude, you cannot be in negativity. So if you were to wake up every morning, do exactly what you're saying, start by something that inspires you, and that could be different. It could be anything. It could be just looking
anything.
At nature. But it could be a speaker. It could be a book. The other thing I always do, and I've done it probably for decades now, is I wake up and the first thing I think about is what I'm grateful for.
Yeah.
It's kind of hard to not feel excited about the day if you wake up and think of what you're grateful for.
Yep, absolutely.
So that's kind of where I think is a fundamental thing. And I think you do that too. You also, I think you journal, don't you?
Yes, I do.
Okay,
I
do. And how often do you journal?
It's here with me right now.
It's here. Well, yeah. We don't have time for you to read it to me, although I'd really love you to, because I want to know what's in there.
Well,
all the secrets in there we could learn.
I tell you, generally what's in there, it's a great question. It starts with identifying what I want. So
now, is this daily or is this weekly? How often do you have a time to go
daily.
In your journal? Okay.
It's defining what I want, getting clarity, right, about what I want. Number two, maintaining integrity to the process that I have to engage in, the things that I have to do in order to have those things. So if I say that I want to be in great physical shape, I define what that means. It means I weigh 185 pounds. I'm able to exercise 6 days a week and compete in Spartan races, for example, which I do. I define that, and then I put together a schedule that allows for that to be a reality. And I have integrity to that process.
Yes. You put integrity behind your words. That's,
yes.
That's a big deal. You, if you can live into your words, that's one of the things I learned probably, I don't know how long ago now, but if you make a decision, the difference between a New Year's resolution that gets carried through and one that doesn't is putting the integrity behind it. So to me, you always have to put the integrity. And those are some kind of a mantra that I have in my mind when I'm thinking of what it is I'm trying to accomplish.
Yeah.
And I just keep thinking, is this moving me towards that goal? Am I living integrity towards that goal?
Right.
And
critical.
I think that makes it's critical. It makes a huge, huge difference.
And then the next thing you said, gratitude, absolutely important. Fear does not exist when we are 100% grateful.
It doesn't.
If we're 100% grateful, there's no room for fear. It's in the moments where there is fear where we've lost our focus on our gratitudes, the things, the blessings, the gifts.
Yeah.
So we got to get refocused on those things. And the last thing is contribution.
Yes.
Most people do not wake up and ask this question, which is critical. Whom can I serve today and how?
Yes.
If we will identify someone or some group that we're going to do something positive for and then work towards that today, it's so much easier for us to maintain a positive attitude because we're always going to be much stronger and more confident in acting in someone else's behalf.
Well, and you're going to feel better. I was always taught that if you want to feel better, help somebody else.
It's simple as
so
that.
So just like today, you came here, you contributed to the listeners, and we are so excited to have you. Want everybody to stay inspired. We look forward to seeing you next time on Achieving It All with Kathleen Bruno. Have a great afternoon.